Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Cubism in many ways is not merely a movement, but it is a kind of earth-shaking, you can say, a discovery of a certain kind of art language which was going to alter the way we perceive art, make art, and understand art once and forever. And like futurism or fauvism, Cubism also, in the beginning at least, was not a very favorable project for many art critics. Instead of appreciation in the beginning, Cubism rather received a lot of criticisms and very negative criticisms. Notwithstanding all this resistance, Cubism and the two most important leaders of the Cubist movement, Picasso and Braque, went on with their project and paved the way for an entirely different kind of aesthetics that was going to rule the modern art ideas for a long time to come. Now, the beginning of Cubism. Well, this particular painting by Pablo Picasso, and the title of the painting in French is La Demoiselle d'Arvigno, is supposed to be the first ever Cubist painting painted by anybody. And this particular painting introduced a revolutionary change in the logic of representation. If you look at this painting carefully, you will see that the figuration, the method of representing the figure to begin with, defies all logic of traditional representational norms. To use a commonplace word, this kind of figuration involves a rampant distortion. But once again, the way Fauvists used colors, the Cubists also did not distort just for the sake of distortion. Or the distortion, though the distortion looks rampant and arbitrary, it was not arbitrary. It was basically in the process of altering the usual, common, traditional representational method. So Pablo Picasso and George Braque, they were the two foremost leaders of Cubism. And more or less the time frame is from 1907 to 1914. And if you look at any Cubist painting, primarily Cubist paintings emphasize flat, two-dimensional surface. Cubist paintings reject perspective, chiaroscuro. And Cubist paintings also reject very easily legible kind of subject matter. In many Cubist paintings, the subject matter, once told, is something very easy to understand, but something extremely difficult to see. There are many Cubist paintings where the subject matter, despite of a very indicative title, visually the subject matter is not visible or very abstract, because the subject matter or the object in the painting has undergone severe linguistic operation and experimentations. And the result is a Cubist painting or a Cubist sculpture. Now, as you can see in this painting, which is considered to be the first ever Cubist painting painted by anybody, in this case it is Picasso in 1907, not a single figure conforms to the normal representational method. All the figures have very sharp, distorted features, including the two on the right-hand side, whose faces don't look like faces, they look like masks. We'll come back to that later on, but also look at the space around these figures. Not realistic, not representational, and moreover, the space around these figures is very ambiguous, confusing, and non-specific, to say the least. So, in most of the Cubist paintings, you see geometric forms dominating without the realistic detail. Cubist paintings refute art as the imitation of nature. It rather follows a certain concept of representation rather than following or imitating nature itself. In Cubist paintings, what you see is a conceived image of an idea or an object rather than a perceived reality. And Cubist paintings usually try to capture the essence of object by showing it from multiple perspectives or multiple points of view simultaneously instead of going for a single point perspective. And interestingly, most of the Cubist paintings, at least in the early phase, are monochromatic. It's only in the later phase of Cubism that you get to see some amount of colors applied on the painting. But in the beginning, they're monochromatic in order to foreground and enhance the flat quality, the Cubist forms and facets, and also in order to stop and resist any suggestion of depth. Some people think that Cubism is a backlash to the Impressionist period's emphasis on light and color, and thereby tending towards an optical reality. After all, Cubist paintings, in spite of some figurative and objective references in some of their paintings like this one, Cubist paintings are by and large, they are not at all interested or bothered with optical reality. They are more interested to deal with the conceptual reality, a certain way of perceiving things and looking at things. Now, though some of the early Cubist paintings, you do find a strong presence of a reference, even if the reference is not realistic, but at least you can make out that this image refers to the figure of a man or a woman or a bottle or a guitar. But these references are going to disappear very soon, and sooner or later, Cubist paintings are going to get very abstract like this one. Though there is a very clear-cut title, very specific title here of this painting. And as the title goes, this painting is supposed to be the portrait of Daniel Henry Conweller, but where is he? Even if you do find some elements, some suggestions of the face of a man, it is so remote from a representational reality, from a realistic imaging, that you almost do not want to claim that you have been able to spot that man. What you actually see is a whole arrangement of geometric forms, angular shapes, and amidst all these shapes and forms, perhaps, at least in this painting, the image of a man surfaces, but that too in a very, very limited extent. Or for that matter, when Picasso tackles his painting, it is not clear. It could be very irritating for a viewer to see that this painting has a title called Guitar Player, but when you look at the painting very carefully, you can't see anything, neither guitar nor player. So now this becomes increasingly clear that in Cubist paintings, as the movement progresses, in the Cubist paintings or sculptures later on, the subject matter for the artist is only a pretext. A pretext or an opportunity to experiment with the language of representation. An opportunity to go beyond the imitative or mimetic language and to produce a work of art which is highly conceptual in nature and also abstract in terms of its pictorial quality. Here, of course, even if we did not have this very specific title called Girl with a Mandolin, but the painting still has a better visual reference to the image of a woman who is holding a mandolin. But what you see here is that the body of the woman as well as the object called mandolin has been broken into fragments. So fragmentation then appears to be a very significant, a very important and a useful tool for the Cubist painters and sculptors in order to create a Cubist image. So multiple perspectives to show an object from multiple points of view and also to fragment, to create fragments from a single object. These are some of the significant and salient features of Cubist work. And the reference to a real human being, a real object, a real space is only marginal. This is what we need to take care of. So Brahman Brah is like Picasso's comrade in this Cubist movement. Even when he also, when he starts his Cubist painting in the beginning, he's also having a very strong reference to a readable, legible image. But like Picasso, in Braque's paintings also, these references are going to disappear very soon. And what you'll be left with is abstract forms, cubist forms, angular shapes, and the flatness of the surface, lack of any pictorial depth in the painting. Like Picasso, Braque also picks up ordinary subject matters, in fact, very simple subject matters, like a fruit ball full of fruits, or a small little landscape, or a man, or a woman, a human being, a human figure. But again, for them, it is only a pretext, an opportunity, a situation to experiment with their Cubist language. So Cubism, as a movement, is an idea which is based heavily on the assumption that in painting and sculpture we can create an alternative language. It is not necessary that a painting or a sculpture has to be a representation or imitation of nature. It can create its own language of representation, where the final image may not look like the original object at all. Yet, it is a justified piece of artwork. So, the titles in the Cubist paintings, of course, help us to get an entry into the painting. But in order to enjoy Cubist paintings, we need to forget the title very soon and enjoy the creative process in which a particular painting, Cubist painting or a Cubist sculpture, has been formed. So, we have seen this painting before. We are looking at it once again. though in this painting the references are pretty clear than many other paintings by either Braque or Picasso. But it would be a good exercise on our part to try to forget these recognizable elements and get into the what we call the abstract structure of the painting, where the realistic references will play a minimum or no role, and what we are supposed to enjoy is its abstract construction. So this is what Cubist paintings or sculptures also expect us, the viewers, to do. In fact, it is often said that Cubist works are a challenge to our cognitive order, because our cognitive order is programmed in a way which makes it difficult for us, at least in the beginning, to enjoy a Cubist painting or sculpture. In fact, for Picasso and Braque too, it was getting slightly difficult because it was getting too abstract, even for them after a few years. So after 1912, both Picasso and Braque thought of bringing in some references, some visible clues in their paintings. So what we see from 1912 is another phase within Cubism. If the first phase, that is from 1907 to 1911, can be called analytic Cubism, where the painters and sculptors were mostly analyzing a form and breaking down the forms in fragments and rearranging the forms once again in a different order, then the second phase can be called synthetic Cubism, when Braque and Picasso both realized that analytical Cubism was becoming more and more abstract and the visual interaction with painting was becoming increasingly difficult for the viewers. So they were certainly thinking about the reception of their art, and both these artists adopted a new approach now known as synthetic Cubism. The most important aspect of this development was the introduction of collage. Not that collage was unknown till then, but until Picasso and Braque used collage in their work, collage was never considered as a serious medium for a serious work of art. So instead of breaking down their objects into facets and reconstructing them, they started with a set of ready-made fragments, wallpapers, paint chair canning, newspapers with patches of paint which they built up or synthesized into more concrete images. So now we can look at a few examples from this second phase of Cubism called synthetic Cubism. The medium of collage certainly allowed a spatial relationship without resorting to the use of conventional perspective. The medium of collage also allowed the artists to use most non-conventional and surprising elements, visual elements like a piece of newspaper or a magazine cutting or an object pasted on the canvas. So, in a sense, it changed also the notion of painting, not only the language of painting, but also the notion of painting. Because until then, in a painting, viewers always expected a painted image. But now, viewers can see that a painting may also have pasted elements. So collage gets elevated. Collage assumes a dignified status in the hands of Picasso and Braque. So the pasted newspaper and also the juxtaposition of a newspaper piece exactly beside something else, maybe a brown paper. And I think this collage also allowed both these artists to introduce textual materials as a part of their painting. This is very interesting. Because the moment there is a text, because because they see something immediately legible, the viewer gets tempted to read the text, which perhaps allows her or him to be drawn into the language of the painting. So, introduction of textual materials as a part of their painting also started from Cubism, and later on, and particularly in the contemporary art scenario, we see a lot of artists across the world are using text and textual materials as a part of their artwork. The legacy can be traced back to Cubism. Now, Cubism or Cubist approach also allowed the artists, not only Picasso and Braque, but other artists as well, to imagine some Cubist sculptures. Not only that, they imagined only, they actually executed Cubist sculptures, where once again, like paintings and sculptures, would refuse to be recognized immediately with reference to any one particular object, but being a three-dimensional thing, as you keep looking at the sculpture and as you keep moving around the sculpture, not only that you begin to recognize the references embedded in the sculpture, but also you begin to enjoy the method of construction. And this is what exactly Cubism and many other art movements in 20th century tried to tell us. That in looking at a work of art, not simply to recognize or identify the object, but also, and perhaps, sometimes only, to enjoy the process of constructing a work of art. Now, with regard to the impact of Cubism, many later art movements like Futurism and of course Cubist sculptures, Picasso's own works, Marcel Duchamp, Constructivism, and many other individual artists got highly inspired by the Cubist notion of space, color, three-dimensionality, fragmentation, and the linguistic experimentations. So though the movement as a Cubism might have come to an end around 1916 and 17, but the impact remained, and it left, Cubism left a very, very strong impact on the succeeding generations of artists and art movements. Now let us look at a few key works by Picasso. Now you look at Picasso's sculptures. Though Picasso made these sculptures slightly later, after the Cubist movement, but the formation of the sculptures, the look and the appearance of the sculptures, the construction of the sculptures are clearly strong kind of reflection of Picasso's own Cubist leaning. Or for that matter, look at these sculptures. It is not only fragmentation, it is also about rearrangement of the individual forms, independent forms, parts of a form into something else. And it is this rearrangement that later, much later, even in 1925, allows Picasso to come up with this kind of fascinating compositions. They look absolutely in order, yet there is a huge amount of rearrangement in with a previous attitude, with something that we have never seen before. Well, even when Picasso is approaching a single form, like you see in this painting called Woman with a Flower in 1932, vaguely there is a reference, there is a trace of a figure of a woman, or maybe even a flower. But what eventually appears, or stays in the painting, is neither the woman nor the flower, but a peculiar arrangement and a configuration of shapes and colors and patterns. So Picasso goes on extending the idea of Cubism in his own works for a long period of time till the end of his career. Like, when you look at these kind of paintings, though these paintings were never a part of the main Cubist movement, but these paintings evidently carry a strong impression of Cubism. If you look at the fragments, if you look at the rearrangement of the forms, if you also look at the element of abstraction in these paintings, Cubism, or the idea of Cubism, is clearly visible in these paintings. Picasso's favorite subjects were musical instruments, still-life objects, and his own friends. He worked for some time in a style using flat colors and simplified forms. All this is true. But in fact, Picasso throughout his career changed his style again and again. No one artist has ever changed his style as much as Picasso did throughout his career. But despite all these changes, stylistic changes that Picasso went through in his own work, the impact and the presence of Cubism remained as a very strong element throughout his life, to the extent that even when he was making small little objects, or very simple paintings, or reconfiguring a very common object or a figure, like a hand, like a cock, or a head of a woman, and all that, everywhere you see that Picasso is very intelligently using, if not Cubist language, but the possibilities of using Cubist elements within a work of art. So Picasso himself was inspired by the experimental freedom of Cubism, and Picasso went down to create a magnificent range of artworks with a playfulness and skill never seen before. In fact, when you look at some of his very interesting sculptures like this, they are playful. Yes, true, but at the same time, these sculptures are testimony to his extremely intelligent way of handling different mediums and objects. Otherwise, no other artist would have even imagined to use a toy motor car as the head and face of a chimpanzee, or for that matter, to use a bicycle seat and the handlebar and reorganize them in a way that they look like the head of a bull. Now, we think that even this playfulness, this quality of playfulness that is evident in many of the works, including sculptures and paintings by Picasso, is directly or indirectly a byproduct of Cubism. To the extent that when in 1937 Picasso painted his famous Guernica as a response to the bombardment and a very, very brutal kind of incident that happened in Guernica in 1937, there's a time of Spanish fascist rulers. They bombarded a small little place in Guernica. So this was Picasso's response. He reacted to that brutality, but the way he expressed the brutality and anguish and violence in this painting, he did not follow either any realistic or representational method. He rather followed a Cubist methodology to express the violence, the brutality, and the tragedy of the most inhuman crime meted out to innocent people by a very powerful fascist government. So Cubism did have a long impact, not only on the history of modern art, but also on the individual artists like Picasso himself.